बायोग्राफी ऑफ सर सुल्तान मोहम्मद शाह आगा खान थर्ड। सर सुल्तान मोहम्मद शाह आगा खान थर्ड वॉज द 48th इमाम ऑफ द शिया इस्माइली मुस्लिम्स, अ डायरेक्ट डेसिडेंट ऑफ फातमी डायनेसिटी। ही वॉज बॉर्न ऑन नवम्बर 2, 1877 इन ब्रिटिश इंडिया टू आगा खान सेकेंड एंड हिज थर्ड वाइफ नवाब आलिया शमसुल मुल्क, who was a granddaughter of Fateh Ali Shah of Persia of Qajar dynasty. In 1885, at the young age of 7, he succeeded his father as 48th Imam of the Shia Ismaili Muslims. Under the care of his mother, he was given not only that religious and oriental education which his position as the religious leader of the Ismailis made indispensable, but a sound European training, a boon denied to his father and paternal grandfather. This blending of the two systems of education produced the happy result of fitting this Muslim chief in an eminent degree both for the sacerdotal functions which pertain to his spiritual position and for those social duties required of a great and enlightened leader which he was called upon to discharge by virtue of his position. He also attended Eton and Cambridge University. On 2nd November 1896, Sir Agha Khan III married to Shahzadi Begum, his first cousin and a granddaughter of Agha Khan I in Pune, India. He again married to Cleope Teresa Magliano in 1908 in North Africa. They had two sons, Josephi Mehdi Khan and Ali Suleiman Khan. Teresa was known as Princess Agha Khan, died in 1926. Following an operation on 1st December 1926. After the death of his second wife, Cleope Teresa Magliano, he married to Henry Josephine Caron on 7 December 1929 in Aix-les-Bains, France. Henry Josephine Caron became Princess Henry Agha Khan. They had one son, Prince Sadruddin Agha Khan, in 1933. Prince Sadruddin Agha Khan had served as United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees from 1966 to 1978. The couple were divorced in 1943. Sir Agha Khan again married on 9th October 1944 in Geneva, Switzerland, Evelyn Blanche Lebrouze. She had been Miss Lyon in 1929 and Miss France in 1930. She is also known as Umme Habiba. In 1954, Sir Agha Khan named her Mata Salamat. Sir Agha Khan was one of the founders and the first president of All India Muslim League in 1906 in Dhaka. In 1934, he was made a member of the Privy Council and served as a member of the League of Nations from 1934 to 1937. He became the president of the League of Nations in 1937. The Agha Khan traveled in distant parts of the world to receive the homage of his followers, and with the object either of settling differences or of advancing their welfare by pecuniary help and personal advice and guidance. The distinction of a Knight Commander of the Indian Empire was conferred upon him by Queen Victoria in 1897 and later Knight Grand Commander in 1902 by Edward VII. He also received like recognition for his public services from the German Emperor, the Sultan of Turkey, the Shah of Persia and other potentates. He was made a Knight Grand Commander of the Indian Empire by George V in 1912. In 1920, the Governor General of India appointed him as Founding Pro-Chancellor of newly created Aligarh Muslim University. He wrote a number of books and papers, two of which are immense importance, namely India in Transition, about the preparation politics of India, and the Memoirs of Agha Khan, his autobiography. Sir Agha Khan died on July 11, 1957 and buried in Aswan, Egypt at the mausoleum of Agha Khan. The Agha Khan was succeeded by his grandson Karim Agha Khan as Agha Khan IV and as the present Imam of the Ismaili Muslims. Association with Aligarh Movement. Sir Agha Khan ascended to the throne of 48th Imam of Ismaili Muslims in August 1885 at an early age of 7 years. The charming prince made his first visit to MAO College at Aligarh in June 1896 at a very young age of 19 years. Sir Syed Ahmad Khan welcomed him in the historical Star Tree Hall. Sir Agha Khan was impressed by Sir Syed Ahmad Khan and his vision and mission. He extended his cooperation to Sir Syed and Aligarh movement and never withdrew till his last breath. Sir Agha Khan believed that the root cause of Muslim backwardness in India was illiteracy, and therefore education was the panacea for their ills. He thought that education should be a medium of service to others and a tool for modernization. He also considered the aim of education to be character building. In his book, The Agha Khan Third, Mr. Islamuddin writes, "It is he who translated the dream of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan into reality by raising the status of MAO College at Aligarh into a great Muslim university." Sardar Iqbal Ali Shah states in The Prince Agha Khan, "It was Sir Syed Ahmad who founded MAO College at Aligarh, but it was the Agha Khan, an ardent, enthusiastic promoter of the ideal of education, who has been mainly responsible for the raising of its status to that of a university." After the death of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan in 1898, Sir Agha Khan III advised Mohsin al-Mulk, the secretary of Aligarh College, to tour India to procure public opinion for the cause of Muslim University. His interest in the Aligarh College dates from the time when he was called upon to preside at an educational conference held at Delhi at the time of Lord Curzon's proclamation Darbar in 1902. He used the platform of Muslims' educational conference to bring home to the Muslims the importance of education and Muslim University at Aligarh. In his presidential address to the Muslim Educational Conference, the Agha Khan said, "If, then, we are really in earnest in deploring the fallen condition of our people, we must unite in an effort for their redemption, and first and foremost of all, an effort must now be made for the foundation of a university where Muslims' youth can get, in addition to modern sciences, a knowledge of their glorious past and religion, and where the whole atmosphere of the place, it being a residential university, nay, like Oxford, give more attention to character than to mere examinations. Muslims of India have legitimate interest in the intellectual development of their co-religionists in Turkey, Persia, Afghanistan, and elsewhere, and the best way of helping them is by making Aligarh Muslim Oxford. We are sure that by founding this university, we can arrest the descendants of Islam. And if we are not willing to make sacrifices for such an end, must I not conclude that we do not really care whether the faith of Islam is dead or not? We want Aligarh to be such a home of learning as to command the same respect of scholars as Berlin or Oxford, Leipzig or Paris. And we want those branches of Muslim learning which are too fast passing into decay to be added by Muslim scholars to the stock of the world's knowledge." Addressing the annual session of Muslims Educational Conference in 1903 at Bombay under the chairmanship of Justice Badruddin Tayyabji, the Agha Khan III said, "The far-sighted among the Muslims of India desire a university where the standard of learning should be the highest, and where the scientific training, there shall be that moral education, that indirect but constant reminder of the eternal difference between right and wrong, which is the soul of education. I earnestly beg of you that the cause of such a university should not be forgotten in the shouts of the marketplace that daily rise amongst us." The plan for the Muslim University had by 1910 taken on the complexion and force of a national movement. The session of All India Muslim Educational Conference at Nagpur in December 1910 was presided by Abdullah Ibn Yusuf Ali Khan. In his address, Sir Agha Khan gave the signal for a concreted nationwide effort to raise the necessary funds for the projected university. In moving the resolution of the university, the Agha Khan III made a stunning speech. He said, "This is a unique occasion as His Majesty the King Emperor is coming out to India. This is a great opportunity for us, and such as is never to arise again during the lifetime of the present generation, and the Muslims should on no account miss it. We must make up and make serious, earnest and sincere efforts to carry into effect the one great essential moment which above all has a large claim on our energy and resources. If we show that we are able to help ourselves and that we are the earnest in our endeavors and ready to make personal sacrifices, I have no doubt whatever that our sympathetic government, which only requires proper guarantees of our earnestness, will come forward to grant us the charter. Now or never seems to be the inevitable situation. To make a concreted drive for the collection of funds, a central foundation committee with Sara Khan III as chairman, with Maulana Shaukat Ali as his secretary, and prominent Muslims from all walks of life as members, was formed at Aligarh on January 10, 1911. The Aga Khan III, accompanied by Maulana Shaukat Ali, who was still in government service and had taken a year's furlough, toured throughout the country to raise funds, visiting Calcutta, Allahabad, Lucknow, Kanpur, Lahore, Bombay, and other places. Willie Fisher, in his book, The Aga Khan, writes, "His campaign for the Aligarh University required a final big heave, and as chairman of the fundraising committee, he went on a collecting tour through India's main Muslim areas. As a mendicant, he announced, 'I am now going out to beg from house to house and from street to street for the children of Indian Muslims.' It was a triumphal tour. Wherever he went, people unharnessed of the horses of his carriage and pulled it themselves for miles. The response to the touching appeal of the Sara Aga Khan III was spontaneous. On his arrival at Lahore, the Daily Peace of Punjab editorially commented and called upon the Muslims to wake up, as the greatest personality and benefactor of Islam was in their city. The paper recalled a remark of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan prophesying the rise of a hand from the unseen world to accomplish his mission. That personality, the paper said, was of the Sir Aga Khan III. On that day, the London Times, commenting upon the visit, regarded him as a great recognized leader of Muslims. Allama Shibli Nomani was with Sir Aga Khan in the delegation for fundraiser to Lahore. Shibli recited a very passionate Persian poetry to motivate the audience for fundraiser. The significant aspect of the Aga Khan's fund collection drive was not the enthusiastic welcome accorded to him, but the house-to-house collection drive. Qayyumul Malik writes in his book, Prince Aga Khan, that once the Aga Khan, on his way to Bombay to collect funds for the university, the Aga Khan stopped his car at the office of a person who was known to be his bitterest critic. The man stood up, bewildered, and asked, "Whom do you want, sir? I have come for your contribution to the Muslim University Fund," said the Aga Khan. The man drew up a check for rupees 5,000. After pocketing the check, the Aga Khan took off his hat and said, "Now, as a beggar, I beg from you something for the children of Islam, but something in the bowl of his mendicant." The man wrote another check for rupees 15,000 with moist eyes and said, "Your Highness, now it is my turn to beg. I beg of you in the name of the most merciful God to forgive me for anything that I may have said against you. I never knew you were so great." The Aga Khan said, "Don't worry, it is my nature to forgive and forget in the cause of Islam and the Muslims." The drive received further greater flip from the announcement of a big donation of 1 lakh rupees by His Highness Nawab Sultan Jahan Begum of Bhopal. The Aga Khan III was so moved by her munificence that in thanking her, he spoke the following words, "Dile banda re zinda kar di, dile Islam re zinda kar di, dile qaum re zinda kar di. Khudai talba tu fail rasool ajrash bedehad." It means, "You put life in the heart of the servant. You put life in the heart of Islam. You put life in the heart of the nation. May God reward you for the sake of the Prophet." In sum, Sara Aga Khan collected 26 lakhs of rupees by July 1912 in the drive, and his personal contribution amounted to 1 lakh rupees. On October 20, 1920, the Aligarh University was granted its official charter. On December 17, the Aligarh Muslim University came into being. According to the Act, Section 3, Sir Aga Khan was appointed as founding pro-chancellor of the Aligarh Muslim University. The inaugural ceremony of university took place on the 17th December 1920. In spite of several obstacles, the Aga Khan continued his ceaseless efforts for the Muslim University and further announced his annual grant ₹10,000 for Aligarh Muslim University, which was subsequently raised. On his behest, a lot of individuals made their generous contributions to Aligarh Muslim University. For instance, Mr. Kasim Ali Jairaj Bhai gave ₹1,25,000 to found chairs of philosophy and science in Aligarh in memory of his father. It must be noted on this juncture that in January 1857, Lord Canning had passed the Act of Incorporation in India, which provided for the establishment of universities in Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. The fourth university was then established in 1882 by a special Act of Incorporation in Punjab, and the fifth was that of Allahabad University in 1887. Thus, by the end of 1902, there were five universities in India, and the demand was to make Aligarh Muslim University as the sixth one. The demand was not accepted till 1920, and instead of sixth, Aligarh Muslim University became 10th University of India, preceded by universities of Calcutta, Bombay, Madras, Punjab, Allahabad, Mysore, Banaras Hindu University, University of Patna, Osmania University, and Aligarh University. It will remain as a historical reminder of the fact that Sir Aga Khan gave continuity to the traditions of his ancestors as pioneers of education in Egypt and elsewhere. Traditions associated with the foundation of Al-Azhar, the oldest existing university in the world, which to this day is crowded with students from all parts of the globe. The Aga Khan III instituted the Aga Khan Foreign Scholarship Program for the promising students. It is worth mentioning here that Dr. Sir Ziauddin Ahmad was one of the students of the Aga Khan in the sense that Aga Khan paid for his years of study at Cambridge. Among other great Muslim scholars who benefited from the munificent help were Dr. L.K. Haider and the well-known economist Mr. Wali Muhammad, a great physicist Dr. Zafrul Hassan, a learned theologian, and Dr. Zaki. The movement of establishing a Muslim university writes Mumtaz Moin in his The Aligarh Movement is an important chapter of our history, initiated by Waqar ul-Mulk. It soon became a life issue under the patronage of Sir Aga Khan. Sir Aga Khan was associated with Aligarh Movement till his last breath. He made numerous visits to Aligarh. In 1936, he suggested to establish engineering and agricultural college in Aligarh Muslim University. His was a regular generous donor to support the Aligarh Muslim University. He delivered 20th convocation address of Aligarh Muslim University in 1940. He served as pro-chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University till April 1930. Aligarh Muslim University honored one of its great patrons by naming one of the hostels after him, Aga Khan.